like to introduce Luke Coughlin, the Worcester Regional Organizer of the Yes
on 2MA initiative. He's speaking in support of question 2, an act to allow fair access to public charter schools. And Luke is here to speak for a little while to talk a bit about the positive sides of that initiative and answer any questions that the committee or other members have. So Luke, please welcome, thank you, and we welcome you speaking to us.
Well, thank you, Mark, and thank you all for having me today. As Mark said, I am Luke Coughlin. I'm with the Yes on 2 campaign, and our goal is to help close the achievement gap in Massachusetts by allowing for the expansion of charter schools and the additional creation of 12 charter schools per year, which would be allowed by this ballot initiative. Right now, there are more than 33,000 kids in Massachusetts who are on waiting lists to get into public charter schools. As good an education system as we have in this state, and we have one and we should be proud of it, there are still public high schools that are unfortunately not up to snuff and not preparing kids for life after high school, not preparing them for college, not preparing them for, you know, having a vocation, unfortunately setting them up in a lot of ways for failure. And parents who live in these areas often don't have very many options. We're talking about parents in Springfield and Holyoke and Lynn, in Boston especially. You have parents who don't have a lot of options. And charter schools have been proven time and again to outperform the kids of public schools. Kids have better standardized test scores, better grades, better disciplinary behavior, and go on to do better things. All kids, it is our position, deserve a chance at the best education they can get, and really that's what our campaign is all about. So I'll open up the floor to any questions you might have.
Talk to us about the money situation. A lot of
right.
people complain that it's taking money out of the public schools, but don't the school systems get money in lieu of that?
Exactly. The opposition to our campaign has come up with this ad campaign, really, that's saying, $450 million being lost every year. But that's not really the case, because in Massachusetts, money is allocated per student. So if 10 students leave traditional public high school X to go to charter high school Y, however much money that school system was spending on the student or the state was spending on those students goes instead to the charter school. But the state will reimburse for 6 years however much money is coming out of that system, and will reimburse actually more than the money is allocated for the student. So really, it's not going to be negatively affecting traditional public high schools at all. We're not, a campaign that's going to be against traditional public high schools. As I said, there are a lot of really great traditional public high schools in the state. But we're just, it's about equal access to good education. And so it's not going to be negatively affecting traditional high schools at all, or traditional school systems generally.
Most people think that it's taking money out of the public.
Right. That seems like, if you hear that, if that's the extent of information you're getting about this campaign, that's good reason to be against it. If you think, they're trying to, destroy these public high schools that we put so much money into and so much time and effort into making so great. But really, it's not the case. We're about serving we're about serving communities that are being underserved, and as I say, closing the achievement gap.
Isn't a lot of it driven by the union?
Yeah. That's where a lot of the opposition is coming from. Well, and again, we're not against teachers' unions. We're not against teachers. I think a lot of the teachers' unions are against the expansion of charter schools because you don't have to be a unionized teacher to work for a charter school. And they see that, I think, in a lot of ways as a threat to the sort of hegemony they have, really, in public education.
And that money comes from the state?
Yep.
That money that's reimbursed to
yep.
the school comes from?
Comes from the state.
Did you say there was an education fund?
Yeah, there's an education fund. It's from, money is allocated, because the money, it changes per year. However much money the state gives to individual school systems. So that's where the money will be coming from.
So if I can clarify, so there's two sides to that. Some folks will be saying, I don't want to see my taxes go up as a result of this initiative. And others will be saying, I don't want to see the money coming to my town for my school to go down as a result of this initiative. And so I don't know the actual numbers. Let's say it was $8,000 per student is what the state is currently funding to the town for students, correct? If that's the number, I don't know if that's the adequate number. But if it was $8,000 and we had 10 students that left to go to a charter school, there'd be $80,000 that some people are thinking we lose, but you're indicating we're not.
It shifts over.
Right, the money's not going to be leaving your district at all. It's going to be coming back from the state. From the state, it goes to your district to reimburse however much money per student that this high school had lost. It's a little tough for me sometimes to keep numbers straight in my head. I would encourage all of you to go to massbudget.org, and there's a really good sort of explainer on how charter schools are funded, nonpartisan and straightforward. I was an English major and history major, not a numbers guy.
But the part that you're not telling me is that it's a line item,
right,
which has to be voted on every year. And they certainly can each year reduce that. You start out with getting 100% back. The law is written that you automatically the next year only get 80% on a student, and the year after that you only get 50% on that same student. Okay? So it's going to go down anyway.
That's the reimbursement.
This is the reimbursement from the state, yes. Okay. And it's a line item, and the state feels free or is free to change that percentage anytime they want. And of course, West Bridgewater's history with state allocation is not particularly good. Things like the CPA, which went from 80% reimbursement, now it's 27. It's only been 5 years. It goes down every year, and we have to fight like hell to get to 27.
And then the South Shore Regional Vocational School, we had real problems with allocations there, too.
Yeah, we had problems with South Shore, too, getting that problem straightened out. So that they're not talking about, or not telling us the whole story, all right? Because it's a gamble. You can say that, well, the state is inclined to give money to education and not necessarily to community preservation. That's probably true. But it's who's got the best lobby. But at any rate, it is a line item, and you're gambling that the legislature every year is going to keep the reimbursement rate the same. And there's no guarantee that it comes with it. And they don't tell you about it. Written into the law is the reduction every year for those students that are part of it, so they don't have to worry about that.
There's no guarantee for tomorrow, either.
No, there really isn't. That's very true.
But that reimbursement component, that's not specific to this initiative. That's in reference to charter schools.
That's how charter schools are currently funded.
So that's happening regardless. Yeah, this is just saying we're going to bump up the number of charter schools
in
general.
Yeah, exactly.
This is bumping up to 12 every year, right?
Additional 12 every year.
Mm-hmm.
And how many are there roughly right now?
Off the top of my head, I do not know. I want to say like 60 something, somewhere around there. But, I don't exactly know off the top of my head how many there are right now. But there are not enough, clearly, because there are 33,000 kids on wait lists to get in. So.
Are you familiar with the charter school that they're trying to open, or they did open in
Brockton? I'd heard about that, yeah.
They had some problems.
It's the community-based problems.
Now they have a temporary...
I'm not really familiar with the problems that had gone with that. Ma'am, you had a question back there?
Two things. One is, I don't know if I missed a stat that you might have given. Of the charter schools that have been opened in Massachusetts, are the lion's share of them shown to be successful and growing and staying open? Or do you have a fair amount that are closed?
That's a good question. Some have closed. But for the most part, these public charter schools have better test scores, have better graduation rates, fewer disciplinary problems, more college preparation than their traditional counterparts. And that's while they are taking the same amount of English language learners, same amount of special needs kids, percentage-wise, as the communities they serve have. So they are, I mean, there's a really great report that had recently come out from the Brookings Institute, which is, again, a nonpartisan institute that actually focused on charter schools in the Boston area and showed that actually kids who go to these charter schools, who are coming from mostly low-income communities, are actually outperforming kids from wealthy white suburbs on tests like the MCAS and other college preparation tests. It's a really remarkable thing. And, you know, as I've said a couple times, we're all about closing the achievement gap. This is exactly what's happening. And parents are, for the most part, ecstatic. You know, I work in Worcester, and I'm talking to parents who send their kids to these charter schools in Worcester, and I can't tell you, you know, I say, oh, well, we're for the expansion of charter schools. And, oh, that's great. You know, my son or my daughter has had such a good experience at Abbey Kelly or at Seven Hills, and, you know, it's a really wonderful thing to see, and we're trying to have it so that every kid can have this opportunity.
So what do you guys chalk that up to then? What is the reason that you credit that charter schools have been largely successful? What is it?
Well, I think one of the reasons they've been so successful is that they're not, these are public schools, but they're not necessarily beholden to the same sort of model that traditional public schools are. And so you can, for example, Abbey Kelly Foster, which is a charter school in Worcester, they have a really strong emphasis on sort of these classic Western texts, you know, that you might not really come across in a traditional high school setting. You might read some, but you wouldn't read all of them. And, you know, looking over their curriculum, it's pretty incredible. You know, you've got kids in 7th and 8th grade reading Dante and Milton, which, you know, I never read Milton in high school. I never read Dante. And so it was, and that's not just it. You know, there's also different teaching models. They've, you know, sort of a more holistic approach a lot of the time, taking the kids' whole day and their living situation into account and not just focusing on them while they're in the building. You know, and just having different options. Because not, you know, a one-size-fits-all education model, I don't think works for, you know, a lot of kids. And being able to be a parent and say, well, I don't think this school is going to work for my kid, I'm going to send him here, you know, A, creates a sense of accountability for all the schools. When parents have options, everyone has to be more accountable.
You can do that now.
Well, not every parent has the financial option to send their kid to another school, unfortunately. We're talking about parents who are mostly from you know, low-income areas, who, if you, you know, unless you can get your kid into BC High on a you know, a scholarship or something, it's not so easy.
But they can pick and choose their own public school.
To the extent that school choice is around.
School choice.
Not all towns participate in school choice. It's not always an option.
Yeah.
And distance-wise, and if the public schools aren't fulfilling that need, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, yeah. The other question I have is the managerial structure, shall we say, for a better word, lack of a better word. I am particularly pleased that in West Bridgewater, my school committee people come up to vote on you 3 years. If you don't like what's going on, you can change it. You have no say in what the structure is or who runs a charter school. A lot of them being out of state, by the way. And we were aware of that. The companies that are sponsoring a lot of the charter schools are out of state. And we have nothing to say about it.
But you don't have to send your kids to that school.
Right. Yeah. You don't have to say over like a private school, you know. You don't have to do it. You can't control how Spelman, you know.
Right.
But private schools don't spend my money.
Huh?
Okay. Charter schools do.
Not
I have no say
they're
on
not really
how they spend my money, okay? Because of the managerial structure, as they say, and most of the profit making goes out of state anyway. It's not, if there's any money to be made, it goes out of state.
I just want to correct that. There's no profits being made. These are all non-profits. There's no money coming out of the charter schools going into people's pockets.
The term nonprofit is a joke. Nonprofit means there isn't any money left, but we get through paying it, is what it means. And you've got directors are getting $1.2 million a year and that kind of thing. And you can't do anything about it because you have no say in electing them or whatever.
I have a question. Is Massachusetts a pioneer with charter schools in terms of the number that we have going as compared to our population? Or are we just kind of in the middle of the path? Or are we, where are we?
Well, the Educational Reform Act of 1993 was the act that allowed charter schools to come into existence in Massachusetts. Other states had had sort of experiments with them before. I want to say Louisiana was the first one to have them. They were big in Louisiana after Katrina destroyed a lot of traditional public schools. And that's a much different dynamic, a much different situation. And there have been situations where charter schools have been very successful in other states, and situations where they haven't been so successful. In Massachusetts, they have been very successful. And just to address your point real quickly, you know, a lot of parents who I've talked to felt like they didn't have any control over the traditional public high schools in their area, despite what the school committee may have voted on or not. So, you know, there has been some concern that these, you know, charter schools are somehow a corporate money-making scheme, and that's, you know, there's just not, they are, you know, think what you will about nonprofits. These aren't, you know, whoever the director may be, that's one person, and the rest of it is structured like a typical school, and it's not, you know, some corporate model that's, you know, taking money from parents or anything, to the, other than then to the extent that they are public schools.
Are there only high school charter schools?
No, I'm sorry. I've been saying X or Y high school, but there are charter schools for all grade levels. Okay.
Can we go on Can we just go back to the money for just a minute?
Sure.
Now, I've seen all the ads and stuff, and they talk about how the charter schools are going to take money away from the public schools. And you were saying that the state is going to reimburse the town. So let's just say, as example, 10 West Bridgewater students leave at $8,000 a year.
Yep.
So that's $80,000 that the school would lose every year, we'll say for the next 4 years. But now it was brought up that it's a line item, and that can be decreased each year. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
It can be, yeah. I would just say that one of the things, getting this question onto the ballot was sort of contingent on working with a lot of people who have ties to the public school system. And it would, I think it would be highly unlikely that the state legislature would allow for a fundamental decrease in the reimbursement levels. Because as I've said, the reimbursement levels aren't changed. This is the model that already exists that is going to continue to exist henceforward, unless there's other laws passed.
So, but it can happen. So that $80,000 a year that we're losing for the next 4 years, by the time we get to year four, could be $40,000, $10,000, could be gone, in theory then. There's no guarantee that we're going to continue to get that same $80,000 that we're losing every year.
Well, you aren't going to get it anyway.
Because
the law is written to decrease every year anyway.
That's what I'm making sure I understand.
Okay.
Is that it's not, when they say that we're not losing money, we are losing money.
But you're losing the students, the whole point, that money is supposed to go to work towards that
student. No, I understand.
You're not losing any money the first year.
That's the point I'm making. The first year.
And after that, it decreases.
You're not actually losing anything in West Bridgewater, though, because we're choice. So we fill those slots, so there's no money lost.
I understand, but I'm asking just to make the point that it's not, the state's not reimbursing you for eternity on this, these students. You get the full amount the first year, but after that, it is going to decrease.
But right.
If you're not teaching that student, you shouldn't have
that
money.
Yeah, that's the point. You know, if kids,
students,
you're getting
I understand that, but that's the point that you made in the beginning, that a lot of these schools aren't providing to meeting the needs of the kids. And you mentioned Springfield, Holyoke, which are very populated areas, and they do have a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. You know, so why, instead of we putting all this money in charter schools, why are we making these places better for all these kids as opposed to just a select few?
Well, we've tried. There's been money going into these public school systems for years and years. Money's been going up every year. Again, I don't have the figures in front of me, but you could look at how much, I think Boston, in particular, spends about as much money per student as any district in the country. And you haven't had, the only way places you've seen increasing test scores is in charter schools and not really in the public schools themselves. Pumping money into these systems has not produced any tangible improvement and charter schools have. So, you know, yeah, it would be great if we could get all these public schools to be better. Whatever internal sort of mechanism has happened is that, you know, that seems to be difficult to do, unfortunately. And it's better that at least some of the kids get to go to charter schools, I would think. And also, you mentioned a lot of these, they are highly populated areas, and there are places with, you know, like too many kids in classrooms and stuff like that. It would, most people think, would actually benefit these schools in some ways to have fewer kids to deal with, too. And these kids are going to charter schools. So it would be, in a lot of ways, a win-win.
And if a parent feels that the needs of that student are not being met in the charter school, can't they go back to the public school?
Yeah.
So it's not they're being forced to stay in a situation that is not working for them.
Isn't part of the point of the charter school approach is kind of like what private schools wanted with vouchers all along, is just giving you more choices and more settings and more options for your child?
Yeah, in a way, it is somewhat. I don't want to compare it to the voucher program, because that's not what it is. Because public charter schools, as are public schools.
Sure.
But in a lot of it is part of the wider umbrella of school choice, which is, I think, an important sort of social justice initiative throughout the country. But it is a public one as opposed to a subsidized private one, which is the voucher program. I don't believe, no, the cap is currently, and this cap we're talking about is the amount that could be allowed per year, and it's not a, it's a stock, and or it's a flow, not a stock, you know, it's something that's set, you know, X amount of charter schools can be created per year, but they're not, that amount is not currently meeting the need. And so we want to raise it so we can create more to meet the need.
Do you guys hear, just qualitatively, what are the most common reasons the people that are sitting on those waiting lists, what is the biggest thing you guys hear for why they want to be on a charter school list?
Because they're not happy with their children's education as it currently stands. And they don't think their kids are getting a fair shake.
Okay, so achievement?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah. Achievement, college preparation.
Do you have a leading from the governor in terms of endorsements or anybody that's giving you...
Oh, Charlie Baker is hugely in favor of this ballot question, as is Lieutenant Governor Karen Polito. And, and there was a Republican town meeting. It's actually a bipartisan issue, too, though. A lot of, plenty of Democratic congressmen have come out in favor of it, and prominent Democrats across the country. So it's really it's a pretty bipartisan issue.
All right, well, I thank you very much, Luke, for joining us. Greatly appreciate you coming in and giving us that perspective on this question.
Of course, thank you all for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right. Next, cruelty to farm animals. Stephanie, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. As was said, my name is Stephanie Harris. I am the Massachusetts State Director with the Humane Society of the United States, as well as the campaign director for Yes on Question 3. So, Question 3 is a modest measure on November's ballot that would finally establish common sense rules for how farm animals are treated, because there are currently no rules regarding the confinement of farm animals in Massachusetts. A yes vote would ensure that certain categories of farm animals, breeding pigs, egg-laying hens, and calves raised for veal, have enough space to stand up, lie down, turn around, and extend their limbs, and ensure that there is a retail standard so that certain products sold in the Commonwealth, meat and eggs, meet that same modest animal welfare and food safety standard. The yes vote is endorsed by the Humane Society of the United States, the MSPCA, Animal Rescue League of Boston, Massachusetts Sierra Club, United Farm Workers, more than 100 Massachusetts family farmers, and more than 500 Massachusetts veterinarians. Currently, across our country and beyond, most farm animals are kept in cruel confinement. And so what does that really look like? Well, hens are typically packed 6 to 8 birds per cage. It's wire mesh cages stacked one on top of another, many cages deep in large warehouses. That's most typical. These hens are living virtually their entire lives on an amount of space smaller than a sheet of paper, essentially two-thirds the size of a sheet of paper, so the size of like an iPad screen. That's where they're eating, sleeping, defecating, and laying their eggs for human consumption. They certainly cannot spread their wings. And today, many breeding pigs and calves raised for veal are also kept in confinement so small that they can't even turn around. Mother pigs are typically artificially inseminated and then locked in this crate that's essentially the dimensions of her own body. So she certainly can't turn around. She's essentially living in a coffin. And like your cat or dog at home, pigs are highly intelligent and social animals. And so when they're kept in this type of confinement with virtually no stimulation, they start to lose their minds. Eventually, they are often seen maniacally biting the bars in front of their face, causing self-harm, and to such an extent that veterinarians actually refer to it as learned helplessness. Eventually, they just give up hope, and they just stare through the bars in front of their face, and that is the existence that they live for virtually their entire lives. Similarly, calves raised for veal are typically taken away from their mother at a single day old and then locked in a crate, essentially the dimensions of his own body. They are typically chained at the neck, so all they can do is stand up and lie down uncomfortably, and that's for weeks until it's time to go to slaughter, and often their muscles have atrophied to such an extent that they can't even walk to slaughter. And these are the conditions that many farm animals endure today, and Massachusetts voters have the opportunity to make a significant impact and shift toward a more humane and more compassionate food system where hens are raised in cage-free conditions. And in cage-free conditions, they're able to engage in basic movement. They're able to dust bathe, they're able to nest, they're able to perch, they're able to engage in a lot of these natural behaviors that are thwarted in this cage confinement. Similarly, breeding pigs and veal calves would shift to group housing. So these animals would be kept, these highly intelligent and social animals would be kept in groups, and they would be able to engage in natural behaviors and, of course, importantly, most basic movement. They'd be able to turn around. And there are impacts beyond the animal welfare concerns with question three. A yes vote on question three is not only important to animal welfare, but it's also important for Massachusetts families because there are serious food safety threats associated with this type of cage confinement. These cages, when hens are kept in these cages, there are significantly higher rates of salmonella in the facilities than there are in their cage-free counterparts. And salmonella is the leading cause of food poisoning-related disease in America today. And Massachusetts families deserve better than to be threatened by these substandard, unsafe, and inhumane products. The Yes on Three campaign launched about a year ago. There are numerous organizations behind it, the Humane Society, MSPCA, Animal Rescue League of Boston, Zoo New England, these animal welfare organizations that are very well known throughout Massachusetts and that really represent mainstream Massachusetts voters. Massachusetts voters, they do care tremendously about animal welfare. And so after 10 years of working for reform at the State House, they came together and decided it was time to move forward with an initiative petition. And as such, we gathered more than 170,000 signatures with the help of more than 1,000 volunteers to qualify for this measure for the ballot. We were, in fact, the only ballot question to qualify without hiring a paid signature firm. We had a tremendous volunteer support, and that really reflects the sentiment throughout Massachusetts, which is incredibly favorable towards this initiative. Most recent polling shows our support as 3 out of 4 Massachusetts voters, and that really spans demographics throughout the Commonwealth. This has tremendous support, and it's part of a global trend in the right direction. It's something that Massachusetts voters really want, and by voting yes on question three, Massachusetts would join 10 other states that have passed similar animal welfare and food safety reforms. Most similarly, California passed a law that was implemented just 2 years ago, And today, the cost of eggs is on par with the national average. And in fact, earlier this summer, their egg prices dropped below the national average. So this is something that will create safer and affordable food for all Massachusetts families. Speaking of cost, since we launched this initiative, more than 200 food companies have pledged to go cage-free. And that includes cost-conscious giants like Dollar Tree, Dollar General, Walmart, Taco Bell, Dunkin' Donuts, and probably most notably McDonald's, which has pledged to go 100% cage-free without changing their prices even a single cent. So we can look to what's happened in what McDonald's is planning to do. We can also look to the egg industry's own studies. Numerous egg industry studies show that it would cost only one penny more per egg to shift from this cruel cage confinement to using cage-free production methods. Further, the pork industry study out of Iowa showed that it can actually be 11% cheaper to use group housing than to use these cruel gestation crates. There are currently thousands of animals in Massachusetts that are kept in these types of conditions, that are kept in these cages. So this measure would have a direct impact on those thousands of animals in Massachusetts, and beyond that, it would prevent factory farms from moving into Massachusetts and protect Massachusetts consumers from unsafe, substandard, and inhumane products in the marketplace. It would rein in any outliers because the market is deciding. As you heard, there are more than 200 food companies that have pledged to go cage-free, so there is a trend in the market, but that doesn't represent everyone. So this will rein in those outliers and then codify the commitments that are already in place from those 200 food companies. A yes vote would prevent animal cruelty, protect food safety, and promote responsible farming, which is why more than 100 Massachusetts family farmers, as well as the United Farm Workers, has endorsed a yes vote on question three. So I'd love to take any questions that you might have. Yeah.
Do you have any idea the percent of farms or companies in Massachusetts that already would classify as compliant because they're either cage-free mm-hmm. or they're not doing the initiatives the way that the ballot question is addressing? Anybody that's already on board, any idea what percent maybe?
Yeah, it's a great question. So the vast majority of Massachusetts farmers are already doing the right thing. Massachusetts farmers overwhelmingly understand that responsible farming means basic husbandry means responsible farming, and that includes giving animals enough space to engage in basic movement. So most farmers are already doing the right thing in Massachusetts.
Awesome. Is the number one objection that you hear for someone who says that they're on board for a no vote, is the number one objection money at the supermarket or money at the farm level or closing farms? What is the big deal just about money?
Well, we don't have a lot of opposition. We don't come across the Massachusetts voters that are opposed to this all too often. We spoke with tens of thousands during our signature drive, and now we're canvassing door to door. We find overwhelming support. However, when there are concerns expressed, it's typically surrounding the cost of food. And so, when you look at the egg industry studies and you look at these food companies and what they've pledged to do and the direction the market is heading, you look at what's happened in the 10 states that have already passed similar laws, you can see that this is absolutely affordable. And with an increase of a few pennies a dozen per egg, when you think about the hidden costs that are involved, there's the hidden cost of animal cruelty, which is paid by the animals, but there's also the hidden cost of food safety, which is paid by individual Massachusetts families, but also by Massachusetts society as a whole when we take on the burden of those healthcare costs.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I think it should be pointed out that Massachusetts by itself does not have sufficient egg capacity to meet the demand. We have to buy eggs from out of state in order to meet the demand in Massachusetts. And people are concerned about the dollar value because in some places, some of the states, California not being one of them, but in some of the states, the price of eggs has gone up. I mean, if you wanted to buy cage-free eggs, you can buy them now. You've been able to buy them for 2 years in Massachusetts at the supermarket. And if you're not a market basket, you can buy them. Mm-hmm. But they're 25 cents a dozen more.
Yeah, so
how do you justify that?
So In Massachusetts today, sometimes you will find that the cost of cage-free eggs is higher than the cost of their cage counterparts, but not always, actually. We find some instances already today where the cage-free eggs are on par with the price of those cage eggs. But right now, retailers are able to charge a premium because cage-free is considered, a higher welfare.
Organic, yeah.
It's a higher welfare product, and so people are willing to pay a little bit more for it. But when the market is trending in this direction already, so you can expect to see that cost come down nationally, and certainly in Massachusetts. And this will. This measure applies even-handedly to producers that want to sell in Massachusetts, whether they're producing in-state or out-of-state.
Yeah. The law that prevents the businesses in Massachusetts from buying non-cage-free eggs from other companies that are not in Massachusetts.
So this would create a retail standard that would ensure that products that are sold in Massachusetts meet that welfare and food safety standards. It would ensure that the eggs that are sold in Massachusetts are cage-free. But as you pointed out, there are other options beyond cage-free, and those would still be available in the supermarket. There would still be, there would be cage-free, there would be omega-enriched, there would be vegetarian fed, there would be free range. So there are plenty of options that would still be available to consumers.
I just wanted to ask, were there initiatives like this? Is there a reason this hasn't been addressed before, like sooner? If this has been going on years and years and years, we've seen Dateline episodes and things from years ago. Why was this not addressed sooner, or was it that the market wasn't ready?
It's a great question. We've been working at the state level, at the state house, to try to pass similar reforms for the last 10 years. And unfortunately, like many good bills, they haven't made it through. But there's been tremendous shift in the last 10 years in what consumers are looking for. And we've seen that in the 10 states that have already passed this initiative and the commitments that we're seeing from companies today. Yeah.
And why is the ballot question limited to those three animals?
So the measure, as you pointed out, it addresses breeding pigs, egg-laying hens, and calves raised for veal. And that's because those are the three categories of farm animals that are typically kept in the most restrictive confinement. So those are the three categories of farm animals that meet this basic criteria of being able to stand. Well, currently they don't. They often don't meet the criteria of being able to stand up, lie down, turn around, and extend their limbs.
And do you anticipate that this would continue to shift toward other animals in the future, as far as
opening up
ballot initiatives?
Yeah, I think that animal welfare reform is fluid, and Massachusetts has proved itself to be a state that does care tremendously about the conditions for animals. And the sole purpose of this ballot initiative is simply to give those three categories of farm animals enough space to stand up, lie down, turn around, and extend their limbs, and that's all it's seeking to do.
Right, it's just trying to meet their basic needs. I mean, it's not changing their end result, it's just giving them a little bit of comfort and before they finally go.
That's right. Yeah, cage-free is not, it's not perfect idyllic conditions, but it is a huge step in the right direction. It means these animals can engage in, as you pointed out, their basic natural behaviors and basic movement. These hens will finally be able to spread their wings.
How does the farmers adjust so that they don't have to raise their prices?
So most Massachusetts farmers are already doing the right thing, but the measure wouldn't take effect until 2022. So it gives ample time to phase out the use of these methods. And cages, like other equipment on the farms, they have a lifespan. And so eventually they would have to be replaced anyway. And so with such an extensive phase-in period, it allows for those cages to depreciate in value and then to shift their models.
But I mean, if it's cages, you're going to have a lot more room, right? If they're not going to keep them in cages.
So typically with cage-free hens, they're often kept in either an aviary-based or floor-based barn system for cage-free. So, when you're looking at the cost of production, there isn't a significant there isn't a significant change. You know, it's the studies have shown that it's 1 to 2 pennies an egg for the shift to cage free from cages for hens, and then with pork, it can actually be, according to the industry study, 11% cheaper to move to this group housing. And with veal, you know, the American Veal Association has already said that they don't believe that there's any place in their industry for these types of crates. They said that they're archaic and inhumane, and so they're seeking to phase them out as well, but they don't represent the entirety of the veal industry. So this measure will, you know, codify the commitments that have already been made and then rein in any outliers. But with the cost of veal, you know, it's typically seen as such a luxury item that people that are buying veal aren't concerned about, you know, pennies here and there.
Just theory about the cost. Somebody once told me I wasn't going to have to pay more for my health insurance.
Yeah, I remember him.
Can you tell us, is there a difference between free range and cage free?
There is, yeah. So this measure would establish cage free as the baseline. The way the measure is actually worded is that it says that these categories of farm animals need enough space to stand up, lie down, turn around, and extend their limbs. And then it defines that specifically for hens as a certain square footage.
Okay. So which is the one that gives them the most space? Is that free range?
So yeah, so this is a very modest measure, and it would only establish cage free. Free range is a higher animal welfare certification. So when you were bringing up the, you know, the cost of eggs, sometimes the comparison is, you know, apples to oranges, because it's looking at you know, conventional cage eggs and comparing that price to free range or organic, which are a higher higher price items, but cage free is not that.
I would think in some ways free range doesn't have to necessarily be a lot more money, because you're dealing with an open space, you're not dealing with individual crates. So wouldn't that expense almost be cheaper? No?
Well, this measure doesn't
address that.
Yeah, it doesn't address that. With cage free, you know, the better conditions for farm animals typically means better conditions for farm workers, which is why the United Farm Workers has endorsed a yes vote on question three. Okay.
Excellent.
Yeah, thank you.
There's
so
no
much
further questions. Thank you very much, Stephanie.
Yeah, we appreciate the opportunity.
Talking about the question.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Okay. Next up, I'd like to introduce Jim Borgasani, speaking in support of question four, the Regulation and Taxation of Marijuana Act. Jim is a communications director for the Yes on Four initiative. Jim, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here. You have a beautiful school, by the way.
Brand new. Just celebrated its first birthday.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, it's really, really nice. Yeah, I live in Duxbury. We built a similar school. We have a combined senior middle school, so it's nice. A good way to go, but this is beautiful. So anyway, I'm speaking. we come at this with two basic premises. First, there are about 900,000 to 1 million regular marijuana users in Massachusetts, and both sides agree on that. That's federal. Federal government has done studies of the marijuana users in every state, and that's about the regular marijuana users in Massachusetts, 900,000 to 1 million. The other premise is that they all go to a market to buy marijuana, and right now that market is dominated by drug dealers and criminals. By definition, marijuana is illegal in Massachusetts. To buy marijuana for the users, they have to go to a criminal market. It's the way our system is set up under prohibition. We want to change that. We think prohibition has failed. We think prohibition has failed to keep marijuana out of our communities. We think it has failed to keep marijuana out of the hands of young people. We think that criminals should not be in charge of any commerce, and we think that this should change. So our proposal is to create a regulated system taxed under the authority of state regulators, just like we control the alcohol industry in Massachusetts. We propose to set up what's called the Cannabis Control Commission. It'll be a three-member commission similar to the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission. They would be appointed by the treasurer of Massachusetts, as is the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission. they would be answerable to the treasurer and to the government. They would set regulations for the entire industry. They would determine who gets licenses, what the application process is for a license, what products they can sell, what those products look like, how they're packaged, how they're marketed, how they're advertised, how they're labeled. They would be in complete control of the market. They would determine, again, who and where these things can be sold. That's what they do. We give local officials the authority to determine where an establishment can be located. So, you know, it's not like somebody can just come and say, we are going to be here. Local officials have zoning control over where these facilities can be located. We give local officials the ability to limit marijuana facilities to 20% of existing package stores. So I don't know how many package stores you have in Winchester, you know, licensed retail package stores. Hypothetically, say you have 10. Selectmen on their own could say we want no more than 2 marijuana facilities. By a simple vote of the people, a ballot vote, you could prohibit marijuana facilities altogether. A simple ballot vote. So local officials would have, we think, significant authority over, you know, where these things are located or whether they're even allowed in their town. We think this would be safer than the system that exists today. We think that a system that's entirely controlled by criminals, which is happening today, you know, maybe when people think legalization, they think, well, you just want everybody to have it and they can do anything they want with it. Well, no, this is regulation. This is something that you can't have as much as you want. We have possession limits. You can have up to 1 ounce on your person, up to 10 ounces in your house, but 9 ounces of that has to be under lock and key. So it's not unlimited possession. It's not unlimited, you know, sales. The people who sell have to be licensed. They have to be regulated. And we think that's a smarter approach than just keep maintaining a system that right now is controlled by criminals. And by the way, when we send these marijuana users into the market, and again, maybe we don't like to think there are marijuana users, but there are, there always will be. Prohibition has not, you know, kept it out of, it's a desirable substance. I don't happen to use marijuana, but I know people who do. That's their substance of choice. They're gonna use it whether it's illegal or not. They'd rather go to a safe place where they're getting product they know has been tested, they know what's in it, they know who grew it, they know who transported it. It's labeled, you can see the potency, and nothing that exists today. It's sort of it's a wild card now when you go out into the market and you buy marijuana. We as a society shouldn't be sending these users into a market where they can be buying anything from anybody because they have no other choice. So we're not introducing anything to the market that doesn't exist. Marijuana is here, again, it's gonna be here before Election Day and after Election Day. The only question is, do we finally want to control it? We think that our system is a good way to do it. Again, we give these regulators full authority over everything. Every aspect of the industry, the regulators will control. Now, our opponents say that this is an industry initiative written by the industry for the industry. That's not true. This is based on a bill that was filed by a representative from Cambridge. It went nowhere in the House or the Senate because there's no appetite for any of this up on Beacon Hill. And so we decided that if it's not going to go the legislative route, we're going to do an initiative petition, which is what we did. That's why it's going to be on the ballot, because the legislature had the chance to do this on their own, and they did nothing. So we brought this before the people. You know, the people are you, and you'll decide which way this goes. I'm trying to think of anything that I haven't covered. But basically, that's the system that we want to set up. We think it's superior to the system that exists now because it will take commerce away from criminals and put it under businesses, tax-paying licensed businesses that are regulated by state officials and by local authorities.
Has anyone on your team looked at Colorado as a test case? Anything at all?
Yes.
Okay, what have you found?
We found that several things. We found that drug driving, in other words, intoxicated driving using marijuana, has not gone up under legalization. Oh, everybody should know, marijuana passed legalization. Marijuana legalized with a regulated and tax system in 2012. Legal sales began in 2014. That was the first year of legal sales. In 2015, OUI, operating under the influence of arrests involving marijuana, actually went down 1.9%. The opponent said it's going to be mayhem on the streets. People are going to be using it. It went down. Despite the fact that there are more police officers trained as drug recognition experts on Colorado roads, so there's extra vigilance, and it still went down. The other thing, teen use has not gone up. They just did a major survey in 2015, the results came out in June, of high school students in Colorado. 17,000 high school students. It's a survey called the Healthy Kids Colorado Survey. They do it every other year, and they ask everything. They ask about bullying, sex, alcohol, marijuana use, and marijuana use is flat. Teens are not using marijuana more under a regulated and tax system than they were before. The governor of Colorado, who originally opposed the initiative, said and has said repeatedly that it's working. They're seeing the criminal market decline. They're getting tax revenue, by the way. That's another thing I should mention. Last year in Colorado, they collected $113 million just in tax revenue from adult marijuana sales. Just adult, we say adult use marijuana sales to differentiate it from medical marijuana sales. Like Colorado has a medical marijuana system, as we do in Massachusetts, although we don't have many dispensaries. But just in the adult use market, recreational, journalists call it, they've made $113 million in tax receipts. $35 million of that went to school projects, you know, new boilers, new roofs, new technology for the schools. A lot of it went to job training programs, opioid treatment beds. So we would like to see those proceeds from Massachusetts go the same way. So the governor of Colorado said, and he said this in June, that pretty much the same people that were using marijuana before the legalization movement are using it after. They haven't seen an increase pretty much in use at all. And we've not only looked at Colorado, we've looked at the other states too. Colorado, Oregon, Washington, and Alaska are the four states that have passed. In none of those states have they seen any increase in traffic fatalities due to marijuana, no increase in teen use, no increase in adult use. It's pretty much the same people using it, except they're getting a tested product in a legal market, and proceeds are going to taxpayers rather than have taxpayers subsidize the market by law enforcement incarceration costs. Yes?
So you said that the possession limits would be the 1 ounce on the person and 10 ounces, or I think is what you said. In the house.
1 ounce on your person.
Yep.
Any more than 1 ounce on your person, and it's a civil fine.
Right.
Between 1 and 2 ounces. If it's more than 2 ounces, then it's the same penalties that exist now. It's a distribution, it's a criminal charge.
Yep. So right now, is there, I don't know if it's already in place or not, the age thing. Is there a set limit for how old for people?
21.
21. So
21 only, it's the same as alcohol. 21.
So for the teen use that, you know, obviously is already happening and whatnot, what would the charges change from what they currently are?
No.
They would be the same?
Same.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
Isn't it still a federal offense, though, if it becomes legal in Massachusetts?
It's, yes.
So that's
a good question. It is still, marijuana is illegal at the federal level. What the federal government has done, they came out with a memo called the DOJ, the Department of Justice, came out with what they call the Cole Memorandum. Because they looked at other states that are legalizing, and there's this tension. How can a state be legal while it's illegal at the federal level? And they said that if a state implements a structured, they use the term robust, regulatory system, then they're going to be pretty much hands off.
That's what this attorney general, what if a new attorney general comes in and completely
difficult to say.
Changes the decision of that previous DOJ?
Yep. That
so
could be a problem.
What would happen? Well, in terms of legalization in Massachusetts at that point in time, I know it's a hypothetical.
It's a hypothetical.
What would be the answer to it?
But it's an excellent question. The answer is there's no answer yet because it's a hypothetical. But what we think would happen is that the government wouldn't interfere in interstate commerce. They just they wouldn't. They wouldn't
like
say
illegal aliens.
Yeah.
Sure, I'm all right.
Yeah, I mean it's a tough call because it could happen. But also remember, in November, there are 7 states that are on the ballot. If California goes, California's a big state, Massachusetts, Maine, Arizona, Nevada, it's going to be more difficult for the feds to come in and say, we're not going to let you do this commerce that your vote has passed. We're not going to allow it to go on. So, you know, it's speculative, but we think that the feds are going to continue, no matter who becomes president, are going to continue with the hands-off approach to a commerce system that is not voted in by the people of the state.
But if someone were to be arrested in, say, a federal land,
yep. Like an Indian reservation?
Well, that's sovereign land.
That's sovereign.
Like a public building, like a nationally recognized, I don't know, like something in Boston or something,
yeah.
where it's federal land.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, for instance, a federal building is, like a federal, whatever, a federal building.
Yeah.
How would that affect?
Well, I think they would let the state, usually the feds, I was okay. in law enforcement, the feds okay. don't take on small cases. If you have 50 pounds of marijuana, that's a federal offense, and you should go to jail,
yeah.
and you should be prosecuted by the feds. We think the feds are going to do a hands-off approach. If they see somebody with a little bit more than the Massachusetts limits allow, I don't think that the U.S. attorney is going to build a case against them.
Okay.
Yes?
How is the control of this going to improve on what we currently have, which is the medical marijuana in Massachusetts, which, by the way, is tax-free.
Tax-free.
And we don't benefit on that one at
right.
all.
Right.
And it's a disaster,
yep.
the way it's been run.
It sure is. Two things. It will remain tax-free, for one thing.
Yeah.
There won't be any tax imposed. This will not be under the Department of Public Health. The reason why we think, and why we made it analogous to the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission, is that we didn't want to saddle another state bureaucracy with the task of implementing a major program and no extra money to do it. That's what's wrong with DPH. What this would do, it would allow people who require medical marijuana or want that as an option to whatever medication they're on, they're going to be able to access it more easily because there's going to be more opportunity to access it. You know, right now, if you live in, say, Truro or Dartmouth, you have to drive all the way to Brockton. It's the nearest dispensary
mm-hmm.
to get it. You only have 7 dispensaries in Massachusetts. It's a torturous process. And we think that by having the option of adult use facilities, these people who choose marijuana as their medicine will have, you know, easier access to it. They will have to pay the taxes on it, you know, until the medical system gets up and running to the point that they can have better access. But another thing I want to point out, I'm glad you asked this. We have talked to many veterans, military veterans, mm-hmm. and federal employees who want to use medical marijuana for a variety of, you know, symptoms, but they're afraid to use it because it's illegal on the federal level. In Massachusetts, to apply for a medical marijuana card, you have to put your name on a centralized list, a database that the state maintains. The state doesn't even maintain a centralized database for gun owners, and we don't. But there is for medical marijuana users. These veterans and federal employees are afraid of losing their pensions or their military benefits because they don't want their employer or their benefactor, the federal government, to find out that they're using a substance that's illegal on the federal level. So it would help them also get access to the drug that, you know, that they choose.
How would it help from that perspective in that it's still illegal federally?
It is, but they wouldn't have to go on a name. Their name wouldn't be on any list. You know, when you go into an adult use facility.
Got it. So as opposed to buying it medically where you're on a list, you're buying it recreationally and you're not on a list.
Correct.
Got it.
Yeah. It's like going into a package store, even though these would be, you know, it wouldn't be like you could go into a store and you could buy groceries and wine and marijuana. These would be dedicated stores. But you don't have to go in and show, or you have to show your ID, but you don't have to give your name. They don't record a name.
Okay.
Yes.
We've attended several DARE classes in the town. We have a terrific DARE program, and they yep. address the kids. And one of the things you hear over and over again that's really important for the kids to get this message is the gateway drug concept. Mm-hmm. We're dealing with our own opiate crisis, like many towns in the state,
yep.
losing over 100 lives in just 4 towns in the last 18 months. It's a lot of death and a lot of people in their 20s. Has anybody looked at the ripple effect? Not necessarily whether marijuana usage has skyrocketed, but people sort of pass through and use it and move on to something else. Has anybody looked at that in terms of part of the impact here?
Yeah, I think a lot of people have looked at that and tried to figure out what is the real gateway to opiates,
right.
to heroin,
right.
you know? And I think that, you know, it depends on what studies you look at. The studies I've seen
right.
have shown that a lot of it starts with the personality of a person and the environment they grew up in. They're finding that a parental absence or social maladjustment for some reason, the inability to interact at a normal level with peers, all build anxieties that sometimes have to be abated, if you will, by choosing a substance. We've talked to many treatment professionals that say this, that you know, there's no gateway. The gateway is your desire to escape something that either you fear or that you know makes you worried or anxious or builds tension. And until people find something that they call reaching the oblivion that they want, that eases their pain, they're going to keep using the substance. It doesn't matter where they start. Unfortunately, that's where they end up with the opioid and the heroin use, because that is, I guess, you know, I've never used it, obviously. I guess that becomes the euphoria that they're looking for, that they can escape these feelings that they have. So and I've heard that the real gateway, the first thing people use, for the most part, is cigarettes. That's the first thing. And then alcohol. And then probably marijuana. And they keep moving on from there. But remember, most people don't go beyond that. The most recent poll on marijuana use in the United States said that 44% of adults have tried marijuana, 44%. But only a tiny percentage ever go on to use, you know, more dangerous drugs. So, you know, there are many studies that look at this, but the studies I've seen, the longitudinal studies that take into effect confounding factors like some of them I mentioned, environmental factors, what is life like at home? Are you picked on in school? Do you have some sort of mental health issue? Those are the things that actually should be the triggering mechanisms that make people think and say, this person needs help.
Okay.
Did you say no tax? No tax on it?
No,
on medical?
On medical, there's no tax. Oh, I'm glad you asked that. Our tax rate would be 12%. Now, we have the regular 6.25% sales tax that you buy, you know, you pay on anything in Massachusetts. We add a 3.75% excise tax, so a special tax on marijuana sales. That would fund the administration of our initiative. So it wouldn't, you know, there wouldn't be a new revenue stream that the legislature would have to dedicate. It would be self-funded by the excise tax, 3.75%. So that makes it a 10% tax. We also give communities the ability to impose a 2% tax. So, you know, say there's a cultivation facility or a testing facility in Bridgewater, you get 2% of their proceeds every year. That's a local option tax, similar to a meal tax. I don't know if you have a meal tax in Bridgewater, but some
places. Yes, we just
said that. Yeah. So it would be a dedicated tax like that, a 2% tax that goes straight to the towns. So it would be 12% total tax rate.
So there's no mitigation money at all for, like, to kick back to programs that help people overcome addictions?
Well, we'd like to see the legislature do that. In Massachusetts, we can't dedicate any funding. In other words, in Colorado, they said that 25% of their proceeds have to go to schools. We can't do that in Massachusetts constitutionally in a citizens' petition, in an initiative petition. We can't say we dedicate a portion of the revenues right toward any particular program. However, we would advocate that, just like you said, we would advocate that it could be used for drug education classes, maybe opioid treatment beds, maybe schools. But we can't require the legislature to do that. So we can't build in any mitigation funding. It's just not constitutional, or else we would have. They do allow it in other states, not in Massachusetts.
Thank you.
Question. Do you personally think that marijuana has negative health effects, that it is addicting, that it impairs judgment, things along those lines, that it is in effect, in itself, has a societal negative to it? And it's something that we should be discouraging rather than encouraging?
Well, I'd like to say that I'm trying to take a realistic approach to it. I would never say that it's a harmless substance. It's an intoxicating substance, just like alcohol. And I would never say that marijuana is harmless. We're not saying that people should use it. Some people maybe have that opinion, that it's a natural product and people should use it. We're saying people are using it. They're going to continue using it. Let's figure out the right way that the market should approach that reality. I have seen studies that say that about 9%, 7 to 9% of people become addicted to it, but it's not a physical addiction. It's a dependency. It's something they like. They like to keep using. It's not like you have physical withdrawal symptoms like you do from alcohol. I'm not a cigarette smoker. I've talked to plenty of people that try to smoke cigarettes, and it's a very, very, nicotine is a very addictive substance, and they do have physical withdrawal symptoms. I've never heard that is the case in marijuana. I've never heard even any of the doctors say that there's physical withdrawal symptoms when you stop using marijuana. But there's a dependency, if not physical, at least it's a product that they like to use. I've seen lots of studies that show that one of the things we hear all the time is that marijuana causes IQ loss in teens. And I've seen studies that show that. I've also seen studies that show, again, if it's a longitudinal over years, tracking people who use marijuana and people that don't, that it all depends on the environment. The famous study, and I'll be very quick about this, there was a study of twins, of 3,000 sets of twins, half of them in Los Angeles, half of them in Minneapolis, so the Minnesota area, and they tracked them for 10 years. One of the twins was a regular marijuana user, moderate to heavy, and the other twin was not. They tracked them and they looked at their school scores, they looked at their law enforcement records if they had any, they looked at all aspects of their growth and their development as adults. They did find that the twin who smoked marijuana lost some IQ points and didn't test as well as people in their peer group. However, they found that the twin who did not use marijuana had the same IQ loss and the same adjustment factors. And they determined, again, like I was saying to the question over here, they determined that it was more environmental factors. It came into what sort of home life do you have? You know, what is happening with your mental health issues? Do you use alcohol? Do you use other drugs? So there are studies, you know, there are studies like any other study that will confirm or rebuke or refute whichever side you're on. I try to look at studies that are by third-party independent researchers, and that tells me that our opponents are probably exaggerating the dangers of marijuana, but I'm certainly not going to say that it's harmless. It's an intoxicating substance, and I think that's why society should take a regulated approach to it and have it labeled and have it packaged in such a way so people know exactly what they're getting, which we don't do now. Yes.
How do you see employee drug testing being affected by this? Because I already know that there are people that are taking medical marijuana prescribed by a doctor, obviously, and they're having trouble at work because they're allowed to use this for their, you know, for their health issues,
yep.
But yet they're not supposed to use it at their job.
Yes. Well, technically, our initiative does not change any drug testing standards that are in place at a business. If there's a practice in place, our initiative doesn't change that. Businesses can continue their structure right now for drug testing.
So you could establish this is a marijuana-free workplace, just like they do a smoke-free workplace.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, by the way, I should mention that public consumption of marijuana would not be allowed under our initiative. You couldn't use it in public, period. So it's the same thing now. So you can't, you won't have people walking down the street. If they do, it's illegal. It's the same as now. The public consumption is prohibited. But I think we have to work out the testing aspect, because the problem with marijuana, with testing, is that it remains in your system for up to 2 weeks, long after the impairment effects have dissipated. So that's why instruments now are being developed. And it becomes a problem when law enforcement gets involved with, say, pulling somebody over who's driving erratically. You can pull anybody over for driving erratically. That's probable cause. And when a police officer pulls somebody over, they don't know if they're drunk. They don't know if they're on drugs. They don't know if they've fallen asleep and have swerved. All they know is that they're driving erratically. That's probable cause. They pull them over. They then conduct a field sobriety test, touch your nose, you know, walk backwards, count to 20, or recite the alphabet backwards or whatever. If you fail, you get pulled off the road. Doesn't matter what substance you're on. And then they make the determination, you know, if they smell alcohol, they do the other things. And if they're drug recognition experts, they're looking for clues as to what, you know, intoxicating substance the person may have ingested. What they don't have and what they need is an instrument that will determine marijuana intoxication. Luckily, that's being developed. And next year, 2017, there's going to be two new tests, handheld field tests for law enforcement. One would test your saliva, and it would test for recent marijuana use, which is the key, because they want to be able to tell that you're actually impaired. So recent marijuana use, that'd be a handheld device that law enforcement could use. The other one they call intelligent fingerprinting. You would put your fingerprint or place your finger on the instrument, and it would detect from your sweat molecules recent marijuana use. So, you know, the technology is catching up with the societal movement toward, you know, relaxing marijuana laws. And this technology never would have been developed if those four states hadn't already, you know, legalized. So it's developing a market that, you know, actually gives law enforcement the tools they need.
It's just, it's a little tricky because you can tell somebody that they can't be drunk on the job, but you don't know if they had a beer last night.
True.
Versus with marijuana, it stays in your system for a long
time. It stays in your system,
and
again,
yet it's not necessarily impacting your behavior at all.
Exactly.
After
it can stay in your system for up to 2 weeks.
Right.
You can detect, they call it cannabinoids. They stay in your fat cells. But the impairment, that's why it's not presence, it's impairment. That's the key. And that's why we think that the instruments are being developed now that will actually test impairment. But if you get pulled over and you're stumbling and the police officer decides you're intoxicated, no matter what substance you're on, you get pulled off the road. Remember, a lot of people refuse breathalyzers. You know, the police often say, well, we have the breathalyzer, we can test. But I think 50% of the people don't, you know, you don't have to take a breathalyzer test. So just by the evidence of your failed field sobriety test, that's when they go in and they try to get a conviction. So, you know, but we think that these tools, they're in development now, they will be in the field in 2017. So we think that will address, you know, some of the issues. But one thing to remember too, we have not seen an increase in intoxication involving marijuana in the other states that have legalized. We just haven't seen it.
I wonder if it does become legal, if the trend will be to eliminate marijuana as the drug that they're testing for in those drug tests.
Interesting. I don't know. It would have to stay as part of it, I would think. Because they have to determine if you're intoxicated. They want to determine what the substance is.
Well, yes, but you're not, generally speaking, you're not being drug tested because you're intoxicated. I'm talking for employers.
Oh, I get it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So if it's legal, and you're not intoxicated by it at the time, it almost wouldn't seem right that after a week and a half you can still get you lose your job over it.
Yeah. Well, there are cases.
Well, depends on the job. I mean, you know, there are some jobs with safety as a key issue. They can say we don't tolerate it at all.
Yes.
And others that'll make the stance, I don't care if it's legal in the state, it's illegal at the federal level. We're going to stand by that. That's going to be our line, and so we'll stand by that.
I think the courts, the case law has started to catch up with this because with the medical marijuana, like you mentioned, there are some people who have tested positive and they've been fired. I know of one case, a woman who was just that. She's a marijuana patient, she has a marijuana card, uses it legitimately, and she was drug tested at work and she was fired. There's a law firm that's bringing her case forward. I think that case will determine a lot, and it will explain a lot, and it will help employers as they approach this, you know. But again, testing impairment, that's the key, you know, impairment and presence. But I think these things will be worked out as a society, if we keep moving forward. And it's not just us, by the way. Canada, in 2017, next year, they are going to, and they're not doing it by province like we are, the entire nation is going to have a regulated and taxed marijuana system. Prohibition is going to end in Canada in 2017. So I think a lot of, you know, different, not only United States, but Mexico, the Supreme Court just came out with a decision that will allow prohibition to eventually end in Mexico. Canada's going that way. So we think society is sort of like, you know, going in this direction.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Well, I think that's all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jim.
Thank you.
You need to go watch a debate?
Ready. No, two more speakers.
Oh, okay, two more?
Two more.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Good.
Okay. That's not the hand lawyer.
Might make those easier for them to follow.
Next up, we have Ken Clippin, president of the National Association of Egg Farmers, in from Philadelphia. He is speaking against question three, an act to prevent cruelty to farm animals. Thank you very much for joining us, Ken.
Well, thank you for inviting me. You're to be commended for actually bringing in speakers to address these issues, because oftentimes not many people do that. They look at what's on the ballot, they read what it says, and then they draw their conclusions from that. My name is Ken Clippin. I am the president of the National Association of Egg Farmers. We have about 200 egg farmers in our association nationwide. The farmers own about 50 million chickens, and they produce about 13 billion eggs per year. So, give you some sort of scope as to the size of our group. We have two offices, one in Philadelphia and one in Washington, D.C., and I'm located in the Philadelphia office. Now, this question number three that's on the ballot on November the 8th, I did a little handout here, and it basically says a yes vote supports the proposal to prohibit the sale of eggs, veal, pork from farm animal confined spaces that prevent the animal from lying down, standing up, extending its limbs, or turning around. And of course, a no vote opposes that proposal. I've been in the poultry business for 40 years. I have 2 degrees in poultry science. Chickens that are in cages can do all those things now. They can lie down, they can stand up, they can extend their limbs, and they can turn around. But it goes deeper than that if you think about this, because question three defines confine as meaning that which prevents the animal from lying down, turn around, fully extend its limbs. But it applies not just to Massachusetts. It applies to all the eggs that are actually coming into Massachusetts. And that's the rub, because that really is, in effect, an attempt to regulate commerce in the state. Now, I've written to your Attorney General last fall. I wrote her. I just took out the Constitution. And on page 2 of that handout that I just handed to you, I cited what it says in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3 of the U.S. Constitution, that in effect, that the regulating of commerce is the responsibility of Congress. And they regulate that among the states. Now, when I was lobbying against what was happening in California, in Washington, D.C., when they were considering another proposal, they kept bringing up Amendment 10. And granted, Amendment 10 does give powers to the states. But if you read the amendment, it says the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states. In effect, it's saying that, yes, the states can make decisions, but they can't go beyond what's already in the Constitution, which is Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3. So I challenged the constitutionality of Question 3. A similar measure was passed in California in 2008, and 6 attorneys general challenged that law as well. And it's now in appeal. So that's one aspect that has some concerns, because of the 6.5 million or so residents in the state of Massachusetts, the number of chickens in the state itself are roughly less than 100,000 chickens. So what we do is we calculate the number of eggs that we consume. If we're an average egg consumer, it takes about 1 chicken per person to satisfy our egg requirements, because our eggs are consumed not just at breakfast, but in mixes, in mayonnaise, cake mixes, etc. So we have to take that into consideration as well. So it's approximately 1 chicken per person. So in effect, you have to import eggs from over 6 million chickens into Massachusetts just to get your needs. And that won't happen with question three, because the states that are surrounding it will not have cage-free eggs available as a result of question three. But that's not all. The next page, I have food safety. perspective. I said resisting the forcing of cage-free, because we really feel like we're being forced into something that we have evolved away from. 50 years ago, when we were producing eggs, we produced eggs among chickens run around on the ground. And we eventually, it evolved into a state where they produce them in cages for health reasons. And this is one of them right here. I quoted from the Journal of Food Control, and this is about 2 years ago. And I won't go through all the detail because it's right in front of you, but it talks about the microbiological contamination of shell eggs from the different systems. One is a cage-free, or what they call free-range, or from a battery cage. Chickens in cages. And the difference is that in cages, the chickens are standing on a wire mesh so that, and forgive me if this is a little crude, but the feces fall through that wire mesh down to a pit or down to some belts below that can actually transport that manure out of the building. That's in a cage system, but in a cage-free system, whether it's indoors or out of doors, the chickens are laying their eggs in the same area where they've also deposited their droppings. So it doesn't really take a scientist to realize that you have manure on your eggshell, you have the potential for contamination. Well, this is a published article that came out 2 years ago that talked about the higher bacterial counts, the pathogenic bacteria on the shell as a result of the eggs that are outdoors or the eggs that are in cage-free environments. The next page is a brand new study that just came out just about 2 weeks ago, this September, and this came from Penn State researchers. They had a six-month study where they collected and tested 6,000 eggs from 200 different selling points across the state. And their conclusions were that the small backyard flocks are more likely to have contaminated eggs than the larger commercial operations. In fact, just yesterday, the Food and Drug Administration shut down a farm in Missouri that was a cage-free or a pasture-raised farm producing eggs because it was contaminated with salmonella. It's the second time that this particular farm was contaminated with salmonella. So the Food and Drug Administration has great reservations about this as well. The next one is just a graph, and it just simply shows, and I mentioned earlier about California actually enforcing a cage-free policy, it wasn't a cage-free policy, it was a policy where they had much larger cages. And at that time, the egg industry tried to show that there would be an impact on the price, a significant impact on the price. And the proponents of that were arguing that the effect would be only pennies per egg. Now, this graph, the top line is the average price in California. And the bottom line is the nationwide average. So from 2014 to 2016, we can see that the spread or the difference between the price of eggs throughout the entire nation compared to California. In 2015, California was 49% higher. Now, there was an outbreak of avian influenza in the Midwest, and so there were some shortages of eggs that had an effect on the product, but still California eggs were higher. I told Californians that they would see the price of eggs over $6 a dozen. They did, throughout all California. 2016, that price spread between the nation's average price for eggs, and these are USDA figures, and California is 90%. So it's not just pennies per egg, it's more than a dollar per dozen. The last page I have is just a summary. I mentioned that I've been in this business for 40 years, and most of the people on this page I've had face-to-face debates with in public forums. The first one, Bruce Friedrich, he used to be with PETA. You perhaps have heard of PETA, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. He went to Farm Sanctuary. He's since then moved on to another organization. Bruce and I debated in Rhode Island in front of some government officials about a year ago, because they were contemplating something very similar to what you're contemplating, and they decided to put it on hold. When I say you, I mean you as voters, but they were doing it as legislators and government officials. But Bruce and I debated in front of them, and when I showed this slide with Bruce sitting right there, there wasn't any reaction. He actually stated in a public forum that eating meat is not your personal decision any more than whether somebody beats their children is their personal decision. Now, what's the point of my bringing that out? It's the thought that these people don't want you to eat meat or drink milk or eat eggs. That's their ultimate objective. The next one is Neil Barnyard. He's the only one I haven't debated among this group. He's with the Physician Committee on Responsible Medicine. His comment was, meat consumption is just as dangerous to public health as tobacco use. Is that how you feel? There was a billboard in Ohio just recently where this organization was claiming that egg consumption would lead to type 2 diabetes. So I filed a formal complaint with the Federal Communications Commission to let them know that I considered that a violation, because there's no evidence to suggest that eggs lead to type 2 diabetes. The third person is Gene Bauer of Farm Sanctuary. He doesn't even hesitate to say he dreams of a vegan world. A vegan world means no meat, no milk, no eggs. He said, that's where I want everyone to go. Josh Bach is in Boston tonight. He's debating somebody that I'm part of, a group that I'm with, a woman that's an attorney that lives in the state, and I think you've seen her name in some of the opinion pieces and some of the Massachusetts papers, the Boston papers. Well, Josh Bach is saying basically in this quotation that cage-free is not inhumane, and yet that's the direction they're pushing us. So do you see that they're not going to stop with cage-free? And the last one, Minion Park, is now with Global Animal Protection. She came right out and said she wants to get rid of the industry, which is me. Just simply wants to put an end to it. So I'm not here to tell you how to vote. That's presumptuous. I've been around long enough to know you shouldn't tell people how to vote. But I'm grateful that you've given me the opportunity to come up here and to just give you a little more information so that you can see that your vote does count, and that question number three is going to have some significant impact. Cornell, I believe it is estimated the cost to Massachusetts will be an increase of about $250 million in your food budget. So that's the reason I came, and I'd be happy to answer any questions at this time. Please.
Do you have any thoughts or in your studies, what was the reason why the smaller flocks had a greater incidence of salmonella than the larger flocks? What was the supposition there?
A lot of it is management, but the smaller flocks also are backyard flocks or flocks that are outdoors. They're not in cage confinement. So those chickens are actually in the presence of the droppings of other chickens. And so the eggs are laid right among those, that manure, and consequently. See, the shell is actually porous. Yeah, the eggshell is porous. There's two shell membranes inside that. And that if you don't treat your eggs properly, meaning that the way they're processed, you have to wash the eggs in warmer water than the temperature of the egg. Otherwise, by osmosis, you have whatever's on the shell actually getting inside the egg. But it shouldn't be there to begin with. So we put the eggs, or put the chickens in cages 50 years ago so that we would remove them from the manure. So these smaller backyard flocks are having more problems. It can be handled by management. If a manager is really doing a top-notch job of collecting eggs as quickly as possible and processing them as quickly as possible. But if they're laid outside, you can't always find the egg, and it might be there for a day or two. In a cage environment, that egg is in your grocery store within 48 hours, oftentimes. So.
Just a follow-up, separate question, but an additional one. Do you see huge differences in the farms that you represent, in the people, in terms of sizes of cages, cushiness, I guess is a good word, maybe, of conditions, in terms of the farmer's state? Do you see a huge range in terms of the conditions that they have for, say, egg-laying hens? Do you see huge variations?
That's a very good question. And that's where California, they went to a larger cage, had a higher ceiling in the cage, and then they added some enhancements to it, meaning they had a perch because they wanted the birds to perch. They had a place where they could scratch, and then they had nest boxes. But the Coalition for Sustainable Egg Supply, which is a group of scientists, including scientists from California and other states, actually reviewed after a two-year study and saw that those enhanced cages, they had more broken bones. Because when a bird is startled, it will run to a part of the cage, it would run into those enhancements like the nest box or into the perch and actually break a wing or break a leg. And certainly that's not humane. The other thing too is that the Coalition for Sustainable Egg Supply looked at death loss, mortality. Just as a population of people have mortality, so a flock of chickens will have mortality. But in a cage environment, it's half of what it would be in a cage-free. In other words, twice as many chickens will die in a cage-free environment. And the reason for that is it's natural. Chickens establish a pecking order among them. They will peck each other to decide, to determine who's dominant. So in a cage with, say, six chickens, they've established the pecking order among those six. Now you take those six and you place them in a house of cage-free birds, say 40,000, you can imagine the chicken that's lowest on the pecking order, how it's going to be treated. So it's the death loss is double. So we have tried to minimize mortality by putting in smaller groups and try to keep them off the ground where the manure is collecting. Okay?
Yes, just one more. Have you seen other initiatives in other states that you can kind of share a little bit of, kind of like the case study learning in terms of what it's told us before Massachusetts proceeds, since we're going to be voting in a month? Anything you've learned from other states that have passed similar initiatives to this or something, so you can give us, I know you mentioned the idea of the egg prices in California, but anything else, residual impacts or stats, anything else you can share?
Well, the information I've given you as it relates to the mortality certainly is evident in other states like Oregon, Washington State, California, Michigan, some of the other states that are doing have done similar initiatives. The incidence of foodborne pathogens like Salmonella, the only incidences we've had reported by the Food and Drug Administration have been in cage-free farms, and there's been two of those in the last 10 months where they had to shut down the farms. The California, the prices is the one that's quantifiable, and that's what I'm trying to show you, where the price routinely is higher throughout the year in a cage-free environment, or even in an enhanced cage environment, the costs are greater. Please.
So you mentioned that something similar has already been passed in California and that there are now appeals to undo it.
Yes.
With that being true, is there a reason why it's even being proposed here?
Well, I never heard back from your Attorney General. I asked, and I cited the Constitution to that. The groups that are proposing it are the groups that I mentioned in the back, some of those like the Humane Society of the United States and the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. They're the ones that are pushing that. I listened to a debate the other day in Boston. I was watching it on television, and it was interesting to hear that the person that was representing the Humane Society of the United States, I've debated him many times in the past over the years. He said they can't even move an inch. Now, had I been the one that was being debated with, I would have said he knows that's not true, because he's been in those barns. They can move. They can even spread their wings. It doesn't mean that they're not going to touch another chicken, but what I've said on television before, when ABC wanted to do a segment on how chickens are raised, I said, let's take those chickens out of that cage and put them on the floor. They will still flock together, the huddle together. Because they're sisters. They come from the same parents. All those. They're all females. And they're hatched from flocks that were related. So you have sisters and cousins, you know, that are together. They will stay together.
I have a question. What is the minimum standard size cage that's currently used for chickens, and how many hens do you put in there?
There is no standard size cage. There is a standard for the amount of space per chicken. So that you can have some farmers, I know one farmer that's providing eggs into Massachusetts, he's got a colony cage. He might have 10, 12 chickens in his cage. But what he will make sure is that the minimum per chicken is 67 square inches. That's for a white shelled egg. For a brown shelled egg, which is popular up here, it's 76 square inches per bird. But remember, it's a colony cage. It's not just that. You have to take six of those or eight of those to show the kind of cage that they're in. So they move around. The birds, the feed trough is up front. They'll move up to the front to feed. They have water, either a water trough or what they call little nipples where they can just touch it and they get water. And that's scattered throughout the cage. So they have ready access to feed and water all the time. And it's a healthy feed as opposed to scratching in the dirt and eating bugs.
Well, I don't think the people that are talking about three, they're not saying that that's what they're feeding the animals. You know, the chickens do scratch the ground. That's a normal behavior for them. And that's part of the yes, is it's prohibiting the normal behavior of the animal and just allowing them certain behaviors that are just normal for them.
A chicken will bathe in the dust.
Yeah.
Okay. To rid itself of ectoparasites. It doesn't do it. It's not doing it because it's fun. It's doing it to get rid of the biting insects. They don't have those biting insects in the cage. A chicken will perch, like any bird will perch, to escape predators. They have no predators in the cage. The fall issue of Audubon magazine, I live not far from Audubon's home in Pennsylvania, and it talks about a cage-free farmer that is having to deal with bald eagles that are actually consuming his chickens. He calculated he's losing about $1,000 a day because the eagles come down and take about four chickens a day. So he's calculated about $1,000 loss per day. Scratching in the dirt, they're looking for something to eat. Well, they can also, the food is right there. It's in ground form, so they can actually peck. They can actually select sometimes a little bit of corn or something that's right in front of them.
Right. I mean, I had chickens growing up. We had over 100 of them living here in West Bridgewater. Our chickens were free range, which is different from cage free, because my understanding with question three is cage free isn't talking about making them free range. Free range is they're just roaming. Like you see a lot of, you know, your neighbors have free range chickens and they come over in your yard and whatever. They're saying cage free, just being they're in a building, they're still confined, but they're just not in the smaller colonies, cages, as you were referring to them as. But now, even as a child, our chickens were fed daily. They had food constantly, mm-hmm. but they still scratched. They still did all of those things because it was a normal behavior. So they're not just scratching, just looking for food. It's a normal behavior for them. They had food available to them 24/7, but they still did that because it's normal behavior.
If you supplied them all the feed they needed in a confined space without allowing them to scratch, would they still scratch?
They have nothing to scratch for because they're on wire.
Yeah.
Even they're if not you on have the a, ground on their normal turf. Even if you they put, don't have anything to perch on. It's just taking away their normal behaviors.
What has happened is when they tried to put like a scratch pad inside of a cage, they would defecate on that. And so that was continuing to keep the manure right in the presence of the cage where the eggs are. So we've eliminated that. So what you say is normal behavior, that's fine for you and for, you know, your neighbors, but we're trying to feed a nation.
I understand that.
And so you're not going to feed a nation with free-range eggs because there's not enough space.
But we're not talking about free-range, it's cage-free. There's a difference between the two.
Absolutely. And in a cage-free environment, they're still establishing a pecking order among the thousands of birds as opposed to the few birds. So the mortality, as I mentioned before, in a cage-free environment is much greater, double what it would be in. And certainly that's a humane consideration. You know, we have to take considerations into consideration. We have to take these factors in. And there is no perfect environment for any of us. I mean, even my driving from the airport here on 93 was not a perfect environment. I don't like to drive, so that was it was a pretty stressful moment. But I did that because it was necessary. I have no problem with people who want to have cage-free or free-range chickens. That's not the problem. What I have a problem with is when they tell everybody it has to be this way. You've taken away people's choices.
Sometimes that's what happens. But you take away people's choices. People want to smoke marijuana. Government says no. That's on the ballot now to make it legal.
That's something I will not address.
But it's a perfect example when you make the statement about people's choices. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not telling anybody how to vote. I'm just trying to give you additional information so you can make an informed decision.
No, I understand that, but I think one of the things that you didn't quite point out was cage-free versus free-range, because they are two totally different things. You mentioned free-range, but that's not what YES allows. It just allows cage-free, meaning of just being in a confined area. There is a difference between those two.
Absolutely. I don't have a problem with that. That's absolutely correct. But how many chickens can you have to supply, say, this community? How many chickens do you think you need to supply this community? And could you do that in a free-range environment, especially when you have predators that swoop down like this farmer that had to deal with?
Yeah, they'll do that bad.
Yeah.
But we're not talking free-range. We're talking cage-free.
That's free-range.
Yeah, right. We're not talking free-range. We're talking
cage-free. You still have confined spaces, but you have that pecking order. So, which do you want? You want to allow them to scratch in the dirt and then die, or you want them to be in a cage and produce more eggs? So, I don't think we're ever going to resolve this one.
This business about interstate commerce, and because Massachusetts cannot grow enough eggs within the state, and we're going to have a problem getting eggs into the state because none of the surrounding states have bought into this. Yeah, and of course that obviously is going to drive the price up of the eggs in Massachusetts, which they say it's not going to happen, but there's no other way, because it means trucking them in from greater distances or something like that. And you can claim that it's unconstitutional because it violates the interstate commerce laws, but you know, in Massachusetts, the Constitution doesn't matter. Because the president has said the Constitution is just a guideline that really doesn't mean anything.
I think it's a
sad outdated guideline.
That's a sad comment when they swear to uphold the Constitution.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when I read this to congressional offices, they just kind of shrugged their shoulders.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, it's in the Constitution.
Yeah. The Supreme Court would let that out.
Well, that's a big issue.
Yes, it is.
Just commenting on the egg industry as you represented it, are you seeing that the biggest threats are regulatory issues coming from within the country, or competition issues coming from outside the country, or other issues? What are the biggest threats to the industry today to survival?
Well, it's not so much the regulatory, because the regulators, they provide an opportunity for comment from people in the industry before they actually...
Do you have input?
So we have input. They publish it in the Federal Register when they're going to propose a new regulation. They give us an opportunity to comment, and then they weigh those factors. So that's not so much the problem. What we see as a bigger threat is what's happening here in this state, where people are being lured into thinking that the chickens can't move in a cage, that the sows that are producing baby pigs can't move at all. They say that's unethical. And we're saying, go visit a farm and actually see that they can move. And the reason that the sow is in that kind of that gestation stall is so that when she rolls over, she doesn't roll over on her baby pigs and smother them. Because that's what will happen. That's what happens in a free-ranging system. in a cage-free environment or a free-range environment, we're going to see dead birds, either by other chickens or by predators or by disease. So we're hoping that that people will sense that the professionals, the farmers, know how to produce. And so they're going to do the best they can produce so that it can meet your needs. California was paying $6 a dozen for a long time. $6 a dozen.
Have you guys tried putting together any sort of a documentary or anything in a video format that could air on a Channel 2 or a Frontline or anything that is available to the public to show almost like a virtual tour of some of the farms to kind of shed light on that? Have you guys considered that, or have you
It's actually in the works right now. There is something that's being done by the American Egg Board out of Chicago. They're charged with trying to promote and research on behalf of the egg industry. And they're actually going to do a virtual video of a farm so that people can see what actually takes place. Hopefully it'll come out before the election.
Yeah, I think we're a video society, and I just think that would be enormously helpful to kind of alleviate.
I wanted to have pictures. I was going to show pictures of a cage-free, a free-range, and a cage, but we didn't have the setup here for that, maybe another time, but I thought just a handout for now.
Yes. Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And this is being filmed too, so lots of other people will get a chance to see it.
Oh, very good.
So it'll be made available.
Excellent. I have another question. We're talking about the pigs being in gestation crates. So are you saying that the pigs are kept in there once they have the babies?
Yes.
They're kept in the gestation crates.
So that the babies can have access to the mother, and she won't smother them when she just rolls over.
So in these same crates, that's what they're kept in, all during the pregnancy?
No.
What I'm asking you.
When they start to produce the babies, then they put them in a gestation stall so that they don't roll over on top of their babies and smother them, because that's what will happen.
I know, we had pigs as a child too. I grew up on a farm, so I do understand that can happen. So what size is this? Because I know these pigs can get quite big. So what size are these gestation stalls or stalls that you're putting them in once they have the piglets?
They're big enough for the pig. I'm not in the pork industry, so I couldn't tell you what the size is. I've been to plenty of those farms, but I never measured them. But they're big enough to allow that sow to lay on her side and the baby pigs to mill about, get underneath the bars so that they can actually nurse and not be... just a fly around here.
I think that's farrowing crates, and the measure doesn't affect farrowing crates. It only impacts gestation crates. Gestation crates are just when the pig is gestating, so when the pig is pregnant, and then they're moved into farrowing crates once they've given birth to the piglets. And so what you're describing is farrowing crates, and that's not impacted by this measure.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Questions?
In the interest of time, because we have another speaker,
thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Trip over in the water here.
Yeah, hopefully we didn't drink this one. Take a seat. I'll introduce you and we'll be all set.
He doesn't know what else our attorney general has to do, take away our Second Amendment rights. I forgot about that. Yeah.
All right, and our last speaker this evening is Craig Pena from the current vice chair of the Brockton Republican
City Committee.
I was getting tossed in city versus town, town committee, as well as a couple other things. I'll leave it to you.
Yeah,
thank you very much. To speak, by the way, against question number two, an act to allow fair access to public charter school.
Yes.
Great, thank you very much for joining us.
And thank you for having me. You know, it's interesting. Everyone left as soon as I got up here. So
Yeah. You've been here a couple of hours. You're fifth on the list of five.
Well, so. I'm not going to take a lot of time because I know you've been here. You've been here a long time, and you want to see the debate.
Exactly,
but I want to give give a little bit of my background because on this question, I've been accused of abandoning my Republican values, and my own brothers called me a rhino. But I know. How about that? But I've been involved in Republican politics in the area for over 20 years now. I'm the current vice chair of the Brockton Republican City Committee, the former chair of the City Committee, current chair of the Ward 1 committee. I'm on the planning board at Brockton, which is interesting. Our meeting ran late because the Board of Health was having a hearing about chickens in Brockton. Interesting for the last speaker. But I've been involved in Republican politics for a number of years, and I first became interested in the whole charter school question when a proposal for a charter school in Brockton came about. And I originally was in favor of charter schools until I started doing my research. And what I found, and what the charter school proponents will tell you, is that it's all about competition. Correct me if I'm wrong, but competition, it kind of assumes a level playing field. What charter schools do not provide a level playing field. They'll say it's all about school choice and competition. Competition is it can be more described as a school choice as it exists right now. We're sitting in a beautiful new high school in West Bridgewater where a large number of Brockton students attend because of school choice. And the whole idea of money following the student, that happens now, that happens today. That's real competition. A public school district is run by the town. It's overseen by a school committee. And there's parent involvement. With a charter school, it's run by a corporation. Whether it's for-profit or non-profit, it has no accountability to the community. And they're run by people who you don't know what kind of experience they have. I can go on for hours about the debacle that's happening in Brockton with New Heights Charter School right now. But what happens is they'll tell you that the money follows a student. And that's true, it does. The average funding per student in Massachusetts is $12,500. In Brockton, it's more like $15,000. But what happens is, like my daughter, she's in 11th grade at Brockton High School. She's taking AP courses and she's got straight A's. She really costs about $5,000 a year to educate. But Brockton is also a special education and ELL magnet. Those students, we have one special ed student that costs $200,000 to educate because this out-of-district placement to the Higashi School. We have ELL students that cost multiples of the $15,000 we receive.
What's an ELL student?
ELL is English language learners. Basically, they used to call it bilingual, but okay. we can't call them bilingual because we have a lot of students coming in from all over the world that speak multiple languages, and English just might not be their language. So we have ELL students all over the place, as you can imagine. We have a large ELL program in Brockton, and those students cost a lot more than $15,000. Now, the charter schools will tell you that they accept everybody. And that's true. They have to accept students by lottery, but they can also counsel students out. So after October 1st, when they find out that student doesn't fit, or there may be disciplinary problems where the student doesn't fit into their Gestapo-type disciplinary rules, they'll counsel them out, send them back to the public school district. And the reason they wait till after October 1st is because that charter school gets to keep that $12,500 or that money that goes with that student, and expel that student and send it back to the public school district, where the public school district does not get reimbursement for another year. So this further hurts the public schools. I just saw something from a friend of mine. If you want to consider a charter school, figure the $12,500 number per student in a school with 26 rooms. Figure three students from each room choose to go to a charter school. That's no real difference in the cost of running the school. But that, if do the math, $12,500 times 60 students, that's a substantial sum of money. So it's about $900,000. I don't know the exact math, but that's about what it is. And that's going to impact the ability of that school to provide services. So basically, I know in a city like Brockton, we'll go from 27 to 30 students per classroom to 27 to 24 students per classroom, and you can't exactly close down classrooms and make them 50 students per classroom to save money on teachers. So what do? We cut custodians, we cut after-school programs, we cut librarians, and we can't allow that to happen. We cut things like music and art, and that's part of education that we cannot continue to cut. So when the question two proponents say that it means more for public school districts, it may mean more. It does not mean more. But what they're alluding to is the fact that when a new charter school comes into town and starts taking students away, the state will reimburse the district on a sliding scale, sliding down for 3 years, the amount of money that they lose. But at the end of 3 years, there's no more reimbursement, and they still have a big hole to fill. And that's something that is not explained in that whole scenario. So just a little bit on my background, and I know you don't want to hear about our struggle in Brockton, but I've been fighting New Heights Charter School for 2 years, and what I found in talking with people on the schools committee is Brockton already offers plenty of choice. We have school choice. We have a lot of students that go to West Bridgewater High School, Avon High School, more than half the population of Southeastern, and a lot of the students in Norfolk Aggie come from Brockton. If we lose money to charter schools, we have to cut off some of the school choice allotment. So there'll be less students from West Bridgewater helping West Bridgewater meet its budget, less students going to Southeastern to meet its budget, and less students going to Avon to meet its budget, because we'll have money siphoned off from a charter school. So it creates more choice, it really is misinformation.
Okay, help me understand that map there. So if Brockton has a charter school,
mm-hmm.
either in Brockton, let's say it's in Brockton.
Well, it's in Norwood now. But, yeah.
But if Brockton would have a charter school and you lose students from the public school to the public charter school, and so your regular public school wound up losing, let's say it's $900,000, so you've taken a hit there. How does that affect how many kids are going to go to, for example, West Bridgewater?
Because when Brockton chose to allow school choice, not every community allows school choice.
Correct. Right.
So if we need to save money somewhere else from our residents leaving the city, we can cut off that school choice, and that school choice can be in the form of less students to West Bridgewater, less students to Avon. There's got to be some way to make up the difference in the money that's lost.
So I didn't think that's how it works.
So to clarify, I just want to ask, because I've wrote about school choice quite a bit. So we're a receiving district.
Yes.
For West Bridgewater. We've had school choice here for a number of years. It's been very successful. Does that mean that Brockton has to, in a sense, give permission to participate? So you guys have to be on the giving end to give permission?
No, because Brockton chose to be a school choice community. We actually have students, we have students coming from as far away as a Sonnet.
Right.
Whose parents went to Brockton High School. They want their children to go to Brockton, or their special ed students.
So you guys receive too.
We receive and we outplace a lot of students,
right.
Because you know some parents are looking for a smaller high school.
Right.
They're looking for vocational education that we don't provide right now.
Playing a sports team or something.
Yes.
Well, you guys have got the Division I
right.
sports reputation.
But,
you're, so you
but
have
your
that.
Control over school choice is whether or not students come into Brockton, not whether they leave Brockton and go to West Bridgewater or Avon or any of the others.
Both.
Yeah.
You would be able to shut it down entirely. It
would be reduced. We wouldn't be able to. It's the as a receiving district. You're right. You cannot. You can receive any students from anywhere.
Right. We
right. anywhere
so
in the state.
West Bridgewater had the ability to say we're going to receive 0 or 100.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But Brockton has no say over that.
So what we
as to whether or not we're going to receive any from
yes.
Brockton. We could get all 100 from Brockton if that's the way the gamble went.
Yeah.
We're doing our lottery and we're getting, you know, we've got 1,000 kids that want to come in.
Right, there's a waiting list. There's a waiting list for Brockton students wanting to come to West Bridgewater.
Sure.
Right.
And so what we'll do is we'll cut down the money that we can send, especially to Southeastern and Norfolk Aggie as well.
Right.
Because those are set up under a different set of rules.
Right.
So what we're really looking at with charter schools is the draining of public money going to a private organization. Just as an example, just recently the National Labor Relations Board just ruled in separate rulings in New York and Pennsylvania that charter schools are actually government contractors because they're not overseen by an elected body. They don't have to receive input from the public. They don't have to have parent advisory councils. They don't have to have school improvement councils. So they're in those states. They're now considered government contractors. Once that question comes up in Massachusetts, we're looking into seeing whether that would put charter schools under subject of the Pacheco Law, which would make public charter schools pay prevailing wage and require the same certifications. Which is another thing charter schools do not require. They don't require certified teachers. They have a history of burning through teachers at a rate of the average charter school teacher lasts 2 years. And so what you're looking at is less experienced teachers, trying to educate kids in a longer day and providing less of an opportunity. I can go on and on about the statistic. We have 25 years of statistics regarding this now, that charter school students, yes, because they can counsel students out, they perform a slightly better, marginally better on MCAS. The city of Boston has proven that. But what they don't do is they underperform in the SAT and they underperform at the college level. Charter schools are geared towards proving their proponents right by scoring well on the MCAS.
Teaching the test,
yes. and what people fail to account for is the public school districts have to educate everybody. In a charter school, they can counsel the specialized students and the ELL students out. But in the public school district, you educate everybody, and the state does not separate the special ed and the ELL from the MCAS scores. We just work very hard in Brockton. Now we have four level one schools, including Brockton High School's a level one school. We're the only urban school district not to have a level four school. For those of you that don't know, the Department of Education and Secondary Education rank schools on their improvement on a scale of 1 to 4, and 1 being the best. We're the only urban district not to have a level four, and we have four level one schools. Most of the district is level in the level two area. But that has a lot to do with the special ed population and the English language learning population and socioeconomic issues as well. We don't have the benefit of a lot of parents who are involved in their students' education as well. And that's an issue that we have to deal with.
I don't know if this applies to Brockton, but the speaker who spoke on the other side of the issue, I don't know if you were here at that point.
No, I wasn't.
Earlier. One of the things that he referenced was waiting lists, 30,000 kids on a waiting list. How do you account for that? And does that apply to the Brockton community?
I will tell you what happened with this waiting list. When New Heights Charter School was going around, because I only have the first-hand experience from New Heights.
Sure.
What they were doing was they were going around to laundromats, asking parents if they want choice for their children. So they had them sign a list. And for the most part, they had no idea what they were signing. This year, when New Heights was supposed to open, and the parents had to request their transcripts, most of the parents had no clue. They did not want their students to leave the public school district. So they really had no idea what was going on. So they've had four lotteries, and they still have slots to fill. So the waiting lists are kind of smoke and mirrors. And actually, on the first day of school, there were at least 35 students who showed up who were transferred out. Basically, the school district had transferred out their transcripts, but the parents still brought them to their public school on the first day of school, not knowing that they were supposed to go to a different school. And then once they found out they had to go to a different school, they wanted nothing to do with it. So I really seriously question these waiting lists that they talk about, because I haven't seen them really exist. Although Mitchell Chester, the commissioner, would disagree with me, but I've seen it firsthand. Any other questions?
Because a lot of them couldn't go to they moved the school out of Brockton, right?
Yes. Well,
a lot of people changed their mind then.
This brings up another question about who is running these schools. We have an organizations come in that we don't know who they are or what kind of qualifications they have or what kind of planning ability they have. There was a school awarded for 315 students between the 6th and 8th grade. And then the second phase are going to go to 9th, 10th, 11th, through high school, or 7th to 9th into high school. But they started, the first, they did not have a building. Then they wanted to build their school on Main Street in downtown Brockton, which was ridiculous. Imagine the traffic jams and the nightmares that would occur there. So then they decided that they terminated their lease. There's currently a pending lawsuit where the landlord, Paul and John Marion, are taking New Heights to court because Paul and John had nothing to do with them terminating their lease. They just decided to terminate their lease, which legally it does not fly. So then they went to the old Verizon building right up the street near Sargent's Plaza, and they didn't pull any permits because they thought they were a school and they didn't have to pull any permits. And now the Department of Education and secondary, elementary and secondary education thinks there's a little funny business going on in Brockton, but the funny business is we have inexperienced people who didn't know that they had to pull permits to convert a building from a commercial use to an educational use, and they didn't think they had to go before the Zoning Board of Appeals and follow the process. There was no plan submitted to the city, so there's no one can vouch for the safety of the school, but they just wanted to go ahead and do it anyway, and now they're blaming the city of Brockton for funny business. So who's running these schools? We just recently had another application for a charter school for Brockton that was denied, but they'll come back. This company out of Long Beach, California, that failed four times in California, now they want to come to Brockton and open up a K-6, K-5 school. And because what they see, West Bridgewater you don't have to worry about a lot of this stuff. What they'll see is they'll see the city of Brockton with a $229 million school budget, and then they'll see an opportunity to make money. Our children only have one shot at an education. The public school system, by and large, in this area, has not failed our children. So why are we gonna meddle with it right now? You can't take a student after 12 years of school and go back and do it over again. There aren't any do-overs when it comes to this. It's too important. So that's why I'm working as hard as I can against question two, because it's just not a good deal for our children. Any other questions?
One last one. Do you get a general feel in the state on which way the tide is turning? Do you get a general idea of where people?
To be honest with you, it's kind of tough because I'm kind of insulated with the people I'm working with. But I also still get a lot of criticism from my Republican friends who don't understand. But I was very disheartened when the question first came around because I knew the money that was going to be poured into the state from the Gates Foundation and the other large foundations and corporations. They're pouring a lot of money into this, and we're a grassroots organization that has no money. But I was disheartened, but I'm starting to feel better about it. I'm not going to say we're going to defeat it, but I'm starting to feel better about it.
Maybe the MTA on the side.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, this is really what it's all about is breaking the teachers' union. That's really what it's all about. But the teachers' union is gonna. I used to be an anti-teachers' union, but when I see what teachers are put through, at one point last year they wanted to tie teachers' jobs, their very jobs, to the performance of their school. So if you teach in an urban district and you're in an underperforming school, you're in danger of losing your job every year. So that's what the union helped them to fight. Teachers do get a bad rap. They people say they get paid too much. Well, if you're in the system for 15 or 20 years, you're going to make a decent income. In a charter school, you're not going to see any teachers around for 15 to 20 years. They're going to last 2, maybe 4 years at the most, and then they're going to try to get into a public school district.
Question. Conscious of what kind of curriculums they have at these charter schools. Do they offer everything that a conventional high school would offer? Sports programs, art, music, that kind of thing?
No.
Highly curriculum?
No.
I know they have a longer school day.
They have a longer school day because they're devoting more time per course, but they don't have the capability of providing the music, the art, and most definitely the sports. With such a long day, they can't provide a sports program. They can't provide the same well-rounded education, the well-rounded individuals that a public school district can do. So that's the simple answer is no.
Yeah. Yeah. Most people aren't aware of that, I don't think.
Yeah, and because a lot of people thought that if they sent their children to a charter school, they can just go to the school.
I mean, yeah.
Yeah, they can just go. If I want to play football, I can go to Brockton High and play football. Well, no, the school does not have to accept them. And from a liability standpoint, if they don't attend that school, they should not be allowing them to play that sport.
Sure.
Any other questions? No. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. Appreciate you coming. Great.
All right. Thank you.
and cruelty to farm animals. Stephanie, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.